Well, good evening, and thank you for joining us tonight. It's good to be back with you tonight after we had to kind of cancel last Wednesday night because of the storm, and everything was just kind of in a mess around here. So it's good to be back for our Wednesdays in the Word. And just a couple of things I want to mention to those of you who are a part of First Baptist Church, a couple of dates that you probably want to keep in mind. The first one is October the 4th. That's Sunday week. That will be a big day as we are kind of focusing on Welcome Home is our theme, and we are encouraging people who have not been back since the pandemic to come back for Sunday school that day and worship. And remember that we offer Sunday school and worship starting on October the 4th at 8:30, and then Sunday school and worship again at 10 o'clock. So that's a big day. And then October the 14th, we will no longer be doing our online Bible study on Wednesday night. It will be in person in our fellowship hall. That will be posted as at a later date if someone cannot attend in person. But my plan is to get back to our study in the book of Jude. We had started a study on in the book of Jude, and we were rolling along, and then all of a sudden, here comes the pandemic. So it's been over 6 months since we have been in that book, but I want to get back in the book of Jude. I want to finish that study because it has tremendous significance, I think, for the life of the church and where we are in these days and what we are encountering and experiencing. So I hope that you'll come October the 14th as we begin our in-person activities back on our church campus. The only thing different is that there will not be any food service. We are not sure when we will be able to bring that back up, but stop by, pick up a meal, and come to the fellowship hall, and you can enjoy it there with your family. But I look forward to that. I started a new series last Sunday morning entitled How It All Ends, in which we are looking at what God's Word has to say about the end time events. We are going to be hanging out most of the time in the book of the Revelation over the next several weeks. And I want us to make sure that we are biblically sound when it comes to understanding the events that are going to take place that God is going to use to bring about the end of the world as we know it today. So hope you come Sunday morning as we will be in our second message on that series. But tonight, I want to talk to us about something out of Psalm 15. So if you have your Bibles, go ahead and open them to Psalm 15. But you know, there are a lot of various events that we experience through life. And once we experience the event, we're not just content to say, okay, I've experienced that event. No, we want to go on and experience the fullness of what the event meant. For example, here's a college football player, and that player develops his skills, does well in college, and then upon graduation, he is drafted by a team in the National Football League, and he's going to become a professional. He's excited about that. Now, is that player content to say, okay, I've signed a contract with this NFL team, so that's enough, that's sufficient, that's all I want to experience? No. That player wants to take the skills that he's learned in college, put them into practice, and then develop that skill set so that he can become the very best professional player that he possibly can. Or, for example, here is someone that stands at a marriage altar and they say, I do, and they go through the ceremony and they are married. Is that person content for, let's say, the next 50 or 60 years maybe to just hold on to that event, that ceremony that happened at one time? No, they want to invest themselves to experience the fullness of what happened on that day when they said, I do. And I really think that that is kind of like what the Christian life is like. Are we content to say, okay, for me personally, say, you know, October the 31st, 1976, I experienced the event of conversion. No, I'm not content with just experiencing that event. I say, okay, now I'm saved. That issue is settled. Now, how do I go on from here? How can I experience all that God wants me to experience in this life that is called the Christian life? How can I live a life where victory is not simply an occasional visitor, but it's something that is with me all the time? You know, how can I live a life where joy takes up residence in my soul? How can I live where I am completely comfortable in God's presence, whether it's through my prayer time or whether it's in a worship service? But how can I live a life where I'm not laden with guilt, but rather I'm living a life where I have, you know, the genuine peace of God in my life? How can I live a life that is pleasing to God and know that I'm living a life that is pleasing to God? I really don't think that I'm the only one asking that question. I think that some of you that are watching tonight and you're engaged in worship online, I think that you're asking that same question as well. I'm saved. I know that I'm saved, but I want to experience the fullness of that experience. How can I know that I'm living a life that is pleasing to God and enjoy intimacy with God like I know that He would have me to experience? I know that King David was asking that very same question, because that's what we see out of Psalm 15. He was asking the question, how can I live a life that is pleasing to God and enjoy the intimacy of my relationship with Him? And he gives us some answers in Psalm 15 when he says in this very well-known psalm, Lord, who shall abide in thy tabernacle? Who shall dwell in thy holy hill? He that walketh uprightly and worketh righteousness and speaketh the truth in his heart. He that backbiteth not with his tongue, nor doeth evil to his neighbor, nor taketh up a reproach against his neighbor, in whose eyes a vile person is condemned, but he honoreth them that fears the Lord. He that sweareth not to his own hurt and changeth not. He that putteth not out his money to usury, but taketh reward against the innocent. He that doeth these things shall not be moved. I think what David is talking about here is that here is the description of a life that is pleasing to God. I think it's important to note that this particular psalm, that this is not a prescription on how to be saved, but it is a prescription or a description of how to live life after we are saved in such a way where that life is pleasing unto the Lord. We know that the Jewish rabbis had about 613 different commandments, and they said that if you're going to live a life that's pleasing to God, you've got to meticulously obey each of these 613 commandments. But here is a psalm where those commandments are greatly reduced. In fact, as we'll see just a little bit later on, the psalmist reduced them to three. And he says, I tell you what, if you live your life focusing on these three things, then you will live a life that is pleasing to God. Now, as far as the background of this psalm is concerned, which is extremely important to understand in interpreting any psalm, most scholars believe that this psalm was written to celebrate the bringing of the Ark of the Covenant to Jerusalem. And so when David brought the Ark back into the city and he placed it in a special tent that had been constructed for it, the arrival of the Ark in Jerusalem basically sanctified the city and gave it a special significance, because that Ark there symbolized the presence of God. And so I would say that I agree with the scholars in believing that that was the background for this psalm, because the focus of this psalm is on the presence of God. Who can hang out in the presence of God? What conduct is required of us to be able to live in the presence of God? And thus, living that way, live a life that is pleasing to God. And so there are three things that are mentioned here that will help us understand the kind of life that is pleasing to God. The first thing that is pointed out down in verse number one is that the life that pleases God is the life that seeks the presence of God. The presence of God. And really seeking the presence of God is seeking the person of God. We see this down in verse number one about the presence of God when the Bible says, "Who shall abide in thy tabernacle?" That's the first important word. Who shall dwell? That's another important word. And in the holy hill, that's the third important phrase that is mentioned in this verse that highlights us to the fact that here David is talking about the presence of the Lord. After the capture of Mount Zion by King David and his men, he moved the ark into that place. That city, the city of Jerusalem, became known as the sanctuary of God. And it became known at that point as the city of David. And the word tabernacle and the phrase holy hill, both of those speak of the presence of God. In fact, the word dwell that is used in this verse is the Hebrew word shekan, and the word shekan is the word that we get the word Shekinah from. Shekinah, glory of God. What does that speak of? It speaks about the manifested presence of God. And so here David is communicating to us the life that pleases God is the life that aggressively seeks the presence of God. And as I said earlier, to seek the presence of God is to seek the person of God. In Psalm 63, the Bible says in verse 1, David again, the author here, and he says, "O God, thou art my God. Early will I seek thee. My soul thirsteth for thee. My flesh longeth for thee in a dry and a thirsty land where no water is, to see thy power and thy glory, so as I have seen thee in the sanctuary." So here is David is seeking the presence of God. In reality, he's seeking the person of God. And he says that we ought to do that early. We ought to do that early in life. I wish that I would have given my life to Jesus when I was a child and not waited until I was 21 years of age, all of those teenage years, that I could have lived my life for the glory of God. I lived those years for Craig and not for him. We ought to seek God early in life. We ought to seek God early in the day. We ought to seek God early in difficult circumstances. We ought to live a life that is seeking the Lord. And you see, our activity is not a substitute for our adoration in seeking Him and seeking to know Him. Knowledge about Him is no substitute for knowledge of Him. We ought to be like the Apostle Paul, who said, "I want to know Him in the power of His resurrection and the fellowship of His sufferings." The greatest pursuit in life is the pursuit of knowing God. This morning in my devotional time, before I came into the office, I was praying and I said, "Lord, I really want to know You. I'm not content just to know about You, but God, I want to know You experientially." I prayed and I said, "Lord, I want to know You in this life before You take me to heaven. I want to know you now. And I think that that's what the psalmist is talking about here. And the good news is that that kind of knowledge is attainable. You know, we get confused sometimes about what eternal life is. What is eternal life? A lot of people think that eternal life is just simply going to heaven when we die. But that's not true. Eternal life is a quality of life that we experience in the now and also in the hereafter. Jesus defined for us eternal life in John 17, verse 3, when He said, "And this is life eternal, that they may know Thee, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom Thou hast sent." That's eternal life. And so could it be possible that there are many people that are saved, they're going to heaven when they die, but they're really not experiencing eternal life because they do not know God personally and intimately right now like God would have them to know Him? Isn't that a great thought that we know God right now? And we shouldn't be content just to know about Him. We ought to have this burning passion in our souls that we want to know Him. Husbands, are you content to just know some things about your wife? No. You want to know your wife. Wives, are you content just to know some things about your husband? No. You want to know your husband. Parents, are we content to just know some things about our children? No. We want to know our children. The most worthy pursuit of life is the pursuit of knowing God. In Jeremiah chapter 9, verses 23 and 24, the Bible says, "Thus saith the Lord, let not the wise man glory in his wisdom, neither let the mighty man glory in his might. Let not the rich man glory in his riches, but let him that glorieth glory in this, that he may understand and knoweth me, that I am the Lord, which exercises loving kindness, judgment, righteousness in the earth. For in these things, God says, I delight." That's what pleases God. That's a life that is pleasing to the Lord. It is a life that seeks the presence of God. And in seeking the presence of God, we seek the person of God. And so I simply challenge us tonight in our Bible study, in our prayer time, in our daily activities, in all that we do, let's seek the presence of God. But then David points out, now there's a second thing involved if we're going to live a life that is pleasing to God. Number one, it seeks the presence of God. But number two, obeys the precepts of God. The precepts of God. Verse number two, "He that walketh uprightly and worketh righteousness and speaketh the truth in his heart." It's interesting here that we see three areas of life that are mentioned in a life that pleases God. And in those areas of life that he's talking about, they deal with our relationship with our fellow man. That should not surprise us because Jesus said all of the law and the prophets hang on these two basic commandments. Love God with all of your heart and love your fellow man. And so he talks about three things that are involved in our relationship with our fellow man. He talks about a blameless character, talks about righteous conduct, and he talks about truthful conversation. Blameless character, righteous conduct, truthful conversation. And that is played out in our walk, in our works, and in our words. In our walk, our works, and our words. And how do we see that here in this passage of Scripture? First of all, I believe that it deals with our integrity. Our integrity. If we want to live a life that pleases God, we make sure that we are men and women of integrity. What is integrity? Integrity is basically blameless character. And it shouldn't surprise us that he starts with character, because character determines what we do, what we say, who we are. And so character, integrity, is extremely important. And when he's talking here about blameless character, he's not talking about sinless perfection. You know, there is no one who reaches that point until they go to be with the Lord Jesus. No, it's not sinlessness. Remember, John says that if we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But to be blameless is to have soundness of character. It's to have the right kind of integrity with God and with man. David revealed integrity after his sin with Bathsheba when he said to the Lord, he said, "Against you and you only have I sinned and done this evil in thy sight." Whereas Ananias and Sapphira, they showed a lack of integrity when they lied about the amount of money they'd given to the church and they tried to practice a cover-up. You see, integrity does the right thing after we have done the wrong thing. Integrity does not mean that we never do anything wrong. Integrity means that after we do something that is wrong, then we turn around and we do what is right. Integrity confesses to both God and to others. Integrity admits when it's wrong. No cover up. There is no biblical character that had more warts than David. And yet God said of David that he is a man after my own heart. Why was that? Was it because he was a sinless man? No, it was because he was a man who had character. So for the person who has integrity, for them, if the shoe fits, they wear it. You know, they don't try to alibi out, but they always do the right thing. And so he's talking here about integrity, blameless character. Then he talks about honesty down in verse 2 when he says, "He that walketh uprightly," and listen, "he that worketh righteousness." He does righteous works. Now, why do I refer to righteous works here as being an indication of honesty? It is because here is a person whose practice, you might say, it matches their profession. It's not the kind of person that James talks about when James talks about a dead faith. That is a faith that says, "I believe," but a faith is not accompanied by good works. So it's an honest life. It's a life that practices what it preaches. The Bible says that the Lord Jesus Christ, he lived a life that was pleasing unto the Father, and he went about doing good. And so the honest life then that pleases the Lord is a life that is consumed with doing good works. And so we naturally ask, "Well, Pastor, what are good works?" Good works are those kind of works that bring glory to God. So a life of integrity, a life of honesty, but also a life of sincerity. The latter part of verse number 2, he talks about speaking the truth in his heart. He's talking about the way that we use our words. Probably David in the Psalms says more about the subject of the tongue than any other writer. And you know, the tongue says so much. I mean, there are probably more blemishes that show up on the tongue than any other part of the human body. We go to the doctor for an examination, he says, "Stick out your tongue." He tells the condition of the body by the condition of the tongue. And that's what David is saying here. That if we are really serious about living a life that's pleasing to God, man, it involves a lot more than just coming to church. We ought to do that. It involves more than just writing out a tithe check. We ought to do that. But it involves the way that we use our words. And so out of these verses, I think that there's some indications here about how that we ought to use our words. He talks about restrained words. Restrained words, "he that backbiteth not with his tongue." If we're going to live a life that's pleasing to God, we got to realize that we got to restrain our words. Be careful about the way that we use our words. And he says here that a person that does not restrain their words are going to descend down into that pit of backbiting, gossiping, and slander. Romans chapter 1, probably the greatest indictment on the human family that we find anywhere in Scripture, takes backbiting and places it right alongside of murderers, homosexuals, fornicators, adulterers. So evidently it's a sin that God is not pleased with at all. Over in Romans chapter 1, it refers to these backbiters as whisperers. That's an interesting idea, whispers. It's the idea of something that is said behind closed doors. It was said that Mary Livingston, who was the wife of the famous missionary to Africa, David Livingston, it is said that she was murdered by backbiters, just as sure as if they would have plunged a dagger into her heart. You see, when David Livingston went to Africa to be a missionary, and he worked out in the bush, his wife Mary was not in good health, and so it was decided that David would go to the mission field, and she would stay at home, keep the children, take care of the house, and she would pray for his work there. Well, after that took place, it wasn't long until the backbiters began their work of gossip and slander, And they begin to say things like, David Livingston, he can't be a man of God. If he were a man of God, surely he would not leave his wife and children behind to take care of themselves. And so she began to hear all these things. And as she began to hear all these things to protect her husband from slander, she moved and she joined David Livingston out there in the bush. And within 3 months, she contracted malaria and she died. And there were those that said that it was the backbiters that killed Mary Livingston. So David is saying here, you know what, if I'm going to live a life that's pleasing to God, I'm going to have to live a life where my words are restrained. But then he also talks about speaking righteous words. He says that in verse 3, the B part of that verse, when he does not speak evil to his neighbor. That word evil there is the word poneros. It's the same word that we get our word pornography from. Evil words. Where do words come? Words come from our thoughts. And so if we're going to use the right kind of words that are pleasing to God, then we've got to have the right kind of thoughts. And that's why Philippians chapter 4 and verse number 8 tells us the kind of things that we ought to think about. Finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of a good report, if there be any virtue, if there be any praise, think on these things. True thoughts, honest thoughts, just thoughts, pure thoughts, lovely thoughts, things that are of a good report, virtuous thoughts. These kind of thoughts, he says, produce the kind of words that we ought to be speaking. Then he says, respectful words. We ought to speak respectful words. In verse number 4, he says, in whose eyes a vile person is condemned, but he that honors them that fears the Lord. Honors them with what? Honors them with our words. We ought to speak respectfully of everybody, especially those who are the household of faith. I wonder if over the next couple of weeks, as the next Supreme Court justice is being examined by the Senate as whether or not to be approved, I wonder if those that are going to be conducting these hearings, I wonder if they ought not to read these words. I'll tell you, my heart is just absolutely so heavy and so grieved by the disrespectful words on both sides of the aisle that we are hearing today. And so he talks about respectful words. But then he talks about reliable words. In the latter part of verse number 4, he talks about our words that do not change. In other words, our yes is yes, our no is no. When we tell someone something, they should be able to rely on what we have said, that our word indeed is our bond. I remember back when I was pastoring in Gulfport, Mississippi. Had not been there but several years, and I had the opportunity to schedule an evangelist who was a very famous evangelist in Southern Baptist life. I'll not mention this evangelist's name because there's some of you who would know him. And I'm not using disrespectful words about the evangelist. I'm just telling you the truth to make my point here, how important our words being reliable are. But I had this evangelist scheduled for a revival. As a matter of fact, it was scheduled out for about a year and a half. 1 week before the revival, maybe it was 2 weeks before the revival, he contacted me. He didn't contact me personally. He had someone in his organization call me and tell me that something had come up and he would not be able to be there to preach for that revival. Well, I just didn't think much about it. Kind of messed up my plans, but went ahead and secured another speaker. But at that time, I received this monthly paper that highlighted events that were happening in other Southern Baptist churches. And what caught my eye was that this evangelist who had canceled the revival at my church, that week was scheduled to preach at the Thomasville Road Baptist Church in Lynchburg, Virginia, where Jerry Falwell was the pastor. That church was a much larger church than the church that I pastored in Gulfport, Mississippi. And I put it all together and I said, yeah, this old boy had an opportunity to preach at a much larger gig. And so he thought that, you know what, I'll probably make a lot more money there. And so he went to preach at that much larger church and he canceled the engagement that he had with me and had given me his word that he would be there. See, there was an evangelist whose words were not reliable. Now, the irony of that story is that when I left Gulfport, Mississippi, and I came to First Baptist Church in Panama City, within a few months, I was contacted by that evangelist, and he wanted to come and, quote, minister at First Baptist Church in Panama City. Well, you know what I told him. That's not going to happen. Well, that's the kind of stuff that David is talking about here. You see, what would have pleased God with the life of that evangelist was him keeping his word and following through with what he said that he would do. That's the way that we live a life that is pleasing unto the Lord. So the life that pleases God, it seeks the presence of God, it obeys the precepts of God, and it's able to stand on the promises of God. In verse number 5, the C part of that verse, he says, he who does these things seeks the presence of God, obeys the precepts of God, is a person of integrity, honesty, sincerity, restrains his words, uses righteous words, uses respectful words, uses reliable words. That person, he says, shall not be moved. Kind of like the Psalm 1 man. He's like a tree that's planted by the rivers of waters. He shall not be moved, and he shall bring forth fruit in his season. I want to just close with reading some verses from Psalm 27. Psalm 27, the Bible says, the Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When the wicked, even my enemies and my foes, come upon me to eat up my flesh, they stumbled and fell. Though a host should encamp against me, my heart shall not fear. Though war would rise up against me, in this will I be confident. One thing I have desired of the Lord, that I will seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple. For in the time of trouble, he shall hide me in his pavilion. In the secret of his tabernacle, he shall hide me. He shall set me upon a rock. Would you bow as we pray together, please? And Father, we are grateful for psalms like these that encourages us to seek the presence of the Lord. Father, I pray that you would put within our hearts a deep passion that we might know you, that we might know you in your power and in your strength, that we might know you in the fellowship of your sufferings, as the Apostle Paul talked about. I pray, O God, that as we come to know you, and Lord, that we live a life that is pleasing to you, God, that we will realize that we're living a life that is anchored to a rock that cannot be moved. And especially in these troublesome times in which we live, God, that we can live a life that we are not shaken and we are not moved. Our Father, we thank you that you have a desire in your heart, God, that we might live this kind of life that's pleasing to you, that we might know you in an intimate way. And Heavenly Father, we want to just join our hearts together tonight in a covenant relationship to pray. God, we pray for our nation. We pray, oh God, in Jesus' name, that you will bring peace where there's turmoil and strife and anger, and God, that you would replace it with your peace. God, we pray for your protection upon our land. We pray for this election season. God, we pray that you would raise up leaders, oh God, that would lead this nation in a way that's close to the desires of the heart of God that are found in Scripture. God, I pray that we as your people would be good citizens, that we would that we would vote. Oh God, I pray for the protection of our leaders. I pray for our president. I pray for our vice president. I pray for all of our senators and congressmen and congresswomen. I pray for our governor. I pray for our local leaders. I pray for the protection of our law enforcement personnel. God, I just pray that we would be good citizens and we would promote those things that Scripture tells us that we are to promote in the communities in which we live. Father, I pray for the life of the First Baptist Church of Panama City. I pray that you would bless us evangelistically. I pray that we would reach our community and beyond with the good news of the gospel. And Father, we want to pray together for our services on Sunday. We pray for the anointing of the Holy Spirit of God to be on this place, on my life as I teach your word, and on those who listen. And we pray that there would be those who would come this Sunday, or those who would watch this Sunday, Lord, whose hearts would be opened to the gospel, whose lives would be transformed by His saving grace. Lord Jesus, we love you. Thank you for our time together tonight. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.